When the Governor-General, Field Marshal Sir William Slim, visits the Australian Staff College at Queenscliff, the Guard of Honour is provided by the Women's Royal Australian Army Corps Training Company, which is stationed at Crow's Nest. Accompanied by the commanding officer of the Staff College, Brigadier Peters, the Governor-General inspects a guard drawn from members of the Staff College and then proceeds on a tour of inspection. The first Staff Training School was established at Victoria Barracks, Sydney in 1938. Since then, the nature and scope of the Staff Training courses have undergone continuous revision and expansion to meet the requirements of modern military training. In 1946, the name of the school was changed to the Australian Staff College to bring it into line with other Empire Staff Colleges. Today, the closest liaison is maintained with Staff Colleges throughout the British Commonwealth, and the work of the Australian Staff College has a high reputation overseas. The length of the course is 12 months, and the comprehensive syllabus is designed to train specially selected officers in the higher aspects of staff work. Of the 31 officers currently attending the course, 20 are members of the Australian Regular Army, while the others come from overseas countries such as Britain, Canada, New Zealand, South Africa, the United States, Pakistan, India, and Burma. The interchange of ideas will be invaluable to these officers, who will play a vital part in the defense of their country. At Puckapunyal, a guard of honor drawn from the 15th National Service Battalion waits for the arrival of the General Officer Commanding Southern Command, Lieutenant-General Sir Horace Robertson, who will take the salute at a farewell parade to mark his retirement from the Australian Regular Army. After inspecting the guard, Sir Horace Robertson moves to the parade ground. Prominent on the parade is Raja II, mascot of the 15th National Service Battalion, which together with the 14th and 20th National Service Battalions form the 1st Infantry Brigade. The presence of the 1st Armoured Brigade on the parade has a special significance because of General Robertson's long association with Australian armoured units. Since his graduation from the Royal Military College, Duntroon, in 1914, General Robertson has had a distinguished career. Beginning with World War I, he served in the Middle East with the 10th Light Horse Regiment and was awarded the DSO for leading his regiment in the cavalry charge at Magdaba, Sinai, in 1916, which was the first ever made by Australian troops. After the war, he served in various staff appointments and also gained further experience in the United Kingdom. In 1927, he formed the 1st Armoured Unit in Australia and then, after further staff appointments, returned to Duntroon as Director of Military Art. In 1939, he was appointed to command the 7th Military District, Darwin, but 1940 saw him commanding the 19th Australian Infantry Brigade in the 1st Libyan campaign, for which he was awarded the CBE. After returning to Australia in 1941 as a Major General, he filled various divisional commands, being appointed Lieutenant General in 1945 when he commanded the 1st Australian Army. A short period as GOC Southern Command followed before his appointment in 1946 as Commander-in-Chief of the British Commonwealth Occupation Force in Japan, being created a KBE in 1950. On the outbreak of the Korean War, he became Commander-in-Chief of British Commonwealth Forces in that zone. He returned to Australia in 1951 to become Director of Recruiting until 1953, when he was appointed GOC Southern Command, a position he held until his retirement. After the parade, General Robertson congratulates Brigadier Knights, commanding officer, 1st Infantry Brigade. He also has a word with some of the national servicemen who are on the parade and to whom will fall the responsibility for carrying on those great traditions in whose establishment General Robertson has played such a significant part. Army School of Health come senior regular Army and CMF medical officers from all over Australia for Exercise Alphabet, which is also attended by the Chief of the General Staff, Lieutenant-General Sir Sidney Rao. In atomic warfare, there will be medical problems on a vast scale, and the Director General of Medical Services, Major General Kingsley Norris, the Deputy Director, Colonel Refshogi, and the school's Chief Instructor, Colonel McClellan, have prepared Exercise Alphabet to present these problems in visual form. Zero hour. A blinding flash and a grey-white cloud mushroom skywards as the Geiger counters begin to click out their ominous warning. This cloud represents the airburst of an atom bomb at 2,000 feet and the effects of the split-second impact of the blast, heat and radiation on troops and field positions are staged in realistic detail. Medical supplies, carefully packed into special containers, are parachuted close to the blast area for use by the medical teams who are already on the job. Escorted by specially briefed instructors, the visiting medical officers and observers move towards the blast area to study the medical problems involved in the protection of troops and the handling of atomic casualties. The field kitchen is nearly a mile from the explosion and would have been hit by a 190-mile-an-hour wind. Sandbags and thick woolen clothing have protected one of the cooks from burns, but the light shirt and shorts have given the other little protection. This truck driver was 1,600 yards from the explosion. Although he was hit by a 200-mile-an-hour wind and badly shocked, his woolen clothing has also saved him from severe burning. 1,200 yards from the explosion, a gunner protected by the shield has been temporarily blinded, but another, caught in the open, has been badly burned. The realistic makeup and painstaking attention to detail is a tribute to the thoroughness with which the Army Medical Corps has reproduced the effects of the explosion. The open mortar pit, 1,000 yards from the explosion, provided little protection when a 480-mile-an-hour wind blasted away its circle of sandbags. Although this tank was shifted bodily 12 feet backwards, its crew were protected from blast and burning and could fight on for some hours before being affected by radiation sickness. The open weapon pit, 800 yards from the explosion, is the most realistic exhibit in the exercise and emphasizes General Rao's comment, "One time the soldier would rather die than dig. Now it is quite certain that if he does not dig, he dies." If a soldier is within 2 miles of the type of atom explosion which Exercise Alphabet represents, he has a good chance of survival if he is well below ground in a slit trench which is covered with at least 18 inches of soil and sandbags. The closing stages of the exercise show the visiting medical officers and observers how casualties would be treated and evacuated, demonstrating in a practical form the methods used in dealing with the medical problems of atomic warfare. In Exercise Alphabet, the Army Medical Corps has shown its awareness of these problems and has presented them with dramatic realism. This will enable those who attended the exercise to return to their units and pass on knowledge based on the latest information on the medical aspects of atomic warfare.